Thank you. The outset, let me thank Anveshan for this opportunity to speak through your platform. This is a time of many such online lectures. It's a season of online lectures, I suppose. But many of you are here, and I'm thankful to you for having spared your time. Now, when Anveshan asked me to give this lecture, they said I should speak on the impact of the pandemic on agriculture. Now, I shall do that. But just as a sort of building a sort of a premise for it, I would like to state a few words about the pandemic and then move on to the lecture per se, rather the topic per se. Now, this is a very unique crisis that we are facing, and there is enough writing on it which explains that quite well. Somebody says can't hear. Will the moderator take care of such issues?
Yeah, I'll take care of that.
Yeah, thanks. This is a rather unique crisis that we have. It is a crisis of there hasn't been a crisis like this for maybe more than a century. Certainly, the Spanish flu of 1918 was the most recent really worldwide pandemic that we had seen. But even the Spanish flu was not did not lock down the world like it has done now. Because that flu happened towards the end of the Second World War, there was already so much destruction and misery around that its impact is very difficult to be sort of distinguished from the impact of the World War itself. What is unique about this crisis is that if we have seen crises which are marked by demand shortfalls or supply shocks or speculations in the financial markets in the past, this is a crisis which probably brings all of them together in some form. There is a simultaneous fall of supply and demand during this crisis, which is not something that we see usually during economic crises. What this results in, well, the neoclassical economics would be in some trouble because they would say that when demand and supply fall together, prices become indeterminate. Now, that's a very vague term, and indeterminate could mean anything. Just that you just can't look for any kind of equilibrium between demand and supply. But that's a very mainstream way of looking at it. But what this crisis marks is not just a fall in demand and supply. There is also the crisis in the real economy slowly spilling out into the financial economy, where large-scale shutdowns can result in a buildup of debts, which can result potentially in banking crisis. Now, it can also result in crisis in the external sector. For example, many countries like India have many large numbers of people working outside, and they send in remittances. The remittances from the Gulf region constitutes a large percentage of India's remittances or foreign exchange reserves that we over time build. Now, this will impact adversely the remittances in a big way. There's an impact in the external sector. It's also possible that we may have large amounts of return migration from the hotspots of migration that we have, including West Asia, because if there are large-scale job losses in those areas, because oil prices are also falling, you may see the return of many migrants from those countries, and you will have to provide employment to them as well. Now, just a small state, Kerala, expects, if it goes to the worst, something like 1 lakh to 2 lakh people to return to that state from the Gulf region. So that's the kind of that's the quantum of return migration that we expect. And for a small state, if that is the quantum of return migration, you could simply expect what it could be for the larger states or the country as a whole. So this is a unique crisis. There is, in some sense, a lot to learn for us Marxists as well in this, because it isn't quite clear how you address this. We can very well say that neoclassical economics does not provide, or neoliberal economics does not provide an answer to this. But let's accept that even we Marxists or our people on the left are in a bit of a bind, because no one has seen a crisis of this sort, and it's very difficult to sort of suggest a concrete policy measure to address this crisis. Now, but at the same time, we can say certain things about how to provide relief and other things. But that's I'll come to that towards a later state of my conversation. Coming to agriculture, now, if you see pandemics of the past, for example, if you see some of the HIV-related pandemics that have been in the past, or the different flus that have, the Asian flu, the Hong Kong flu, or more recently the Ebola outbreak of Africa, countries like Sierra Leone and so on, you would see that most pandemics have resulted in a sharp increase in food prices. A sharp increase in food prices has led to the exclusion of a large number of people from the consumption of food. So hunger, malnourishment have particularly risen among the vulnerable people when such pandemics have hit in the past. During 2007-8, there was a very sharp spike of world food prices. That also, we know, led to, though it was not a pandemic, we know also that that kind of a process can lead to enormous amounts of hunger and malnourishment among the vulnerable sections and also society at large. So one expect from the experiences that we have across the world, we very well know that such pandemics can potentially result in rise in food prices, exclusion of people from food consumption, a rise in hunger, malnourishment, etc. That's something that we expect anyway. But nobody really thought that there could be a worldwide pandemic of this sort. If Africa had a food crisis, the rest of the world could send food aid to Africa to help people in the pandemic. But here, the whole world is in crisis. From where will you send where? No exports or imports are happening worth a quantity. So this means that even when we look at the past experiences related to agriculture, food on the one side and pandemics on the other, even there, this pandemic has its specificities in terms of the fact that it's a worldwide concern and no one country can send food aid to another set of countries and help them tide over the crisis period. So here again, there is a novelty in the nature of crisis that we face. Now, let me come to agriculture per se. One thing that most international organizations, may it be the Food and Agriculture Organization, the World Food Program, the United Nations, United Nations Security Council, or the WHO, all of them, what they want is of a food shortage, food crisis, potential food riots, large-scale hunger, malnourishment, etc. These are typical impacts that you expect during a pandemic, which you know from experiences in the past. Nevertheless, as I said earlier, because of the uniqueness of the crisis, it's very difficult to forecast with any certainty as to what the impact could be, how much the impact could be, what kind of how much hunger would there be, would there be enough food for the world to eat, say 6 months from now, 3 months from now. It's very difficult to forecast all that because you simply don't know till when the lockdown would last, number one. Number two, you also do not know if there will be a return of the pandemic at a later stage. One argument we all have probably heard is that when winter sets in later in the year in the Western countries, there might be a return of the pandemic to those countries and lockdowns may come back to haunt us. So that's another worry that we all have. So how long will this pandemic last or lockdown persist, we do not know. So that sort of gives us puts us in some kind of a trouble with respect to forecasting what will happen in the food sector or the agricultural sector. Nevertheless, what we can do is to sort of look at some specific indicators and see what has happened to those indicators in the time that is passed. That is, say, the last month or month and a half, say from March 20 or in India, March 24th, up to now, what has happened to different indicators that we can put together in this regard. Now, I try to do it in this conversation. I shall try to put it in about three or four subheads. Number one, the question to ask is, what is happening to, is there enough food to eat for the world? Is there enough food supply for the world and India? That's the first question to ask. The second question to ask is, okay, it's quite possible that there is enough food at a national macro level, but we all know that that has never meant eradication of hunger. We know that excess food stocks can very well go together with high levels of hunger and malnourishment. So another question using a proxy you can ask is, what is happening to food prices? How are food prices behaving in terms of which can tell us a little bit about whether people are in, excluded from the consumption of food or not. The third question that we can ask is, what is happening to farmers, which is very important, which should be a very important concern when we look at the impacts of the pandemic in rural areas. The fourth question to ask would be, what is happening to laborers who do not have land, who are not farmers per se, but who are dependent on those who are cultivating land. Now, these are four sets of concerns that we can examine with some depth of analysis due for the period that has just passed. Some of the information is the things that I have put together over a while. Also, I shall use some studies which have come out, quite interesting studies which have come, which throw more light on the problem at hand. Okay, now, what is happening to world food stocks? Now, FAO tells us that this is a very good year. There is no need to worry about food stocks. We all have excellent supplies of particularly rice, wheat kind of cereals, and there shouldn't be much to worry. The United States Department of Agriculture tells us that the world production of rice and wheat is likely to be a record of 1.26 billion tons this year. That's the kind of estimate that they put forward. This production data that we have is supposedly more than, it's greater than the total consumption of rice and wheat in 2019-20. So we already have an expected production of 1.26 billion tons in the world this year, which is more than the total consumption of rice and wheat for the whole world. Now, how much stocks do we have? FAO says that we have a stocks to use ratio, which is stock divided by consumption into 100, a stocks to use ratio of about 30% for food grains and cereals as a whole, about 35% for rice, 35% for wheat, and about 28-29% for coarse grains. And they call it very satisfactory. That means about a third of our total consumption we already have as buffer stocks in the world. So here again, there is another sort of sense of optimism that is put in by these global organizations, where they say that we have enough production to feed our population in the coming year, so there isn't much to worry. But is that true? There is nothing much to worry? Strains have already begun to appear. What is it that I'm referring to? The key point is, when we speak of world stocks, there isn't one place in the world where all these stocks are kept and there is somebody distributing it equally across countries. World stocks are simply a mathematical addition of all the national stocks that we have. So national stocks are not the same as global stocks. If you look at a commodity like wheat, you will see that's more than half of the total world stocks are with one country, China. If you take rice, more than 20% of the total stock of rice that we have is with one country, India. Now, this means that there is geographically, there is some amount of concentration that we have in the buffer stocks that are stored in different countries, and these are sovereign countries. Only if these countries agree to trade can these commodities reach through export and import channels other countries which are hungry or which are needy. Now, that is something that has come under extreme strain now. Why is it so? Because many countries have stopped trade because they have gone into a precautionary mode. And what they have done is that they have stopped trade in anticipation of a food crisis that might come in the coming few months. World's largest exporters have either reduced their extent of trade or they have simply stopped trading. Two countries that have stopped trading are third largest exporters of rice and wheat in the world. Vietnam, the third largest rice exporter, and Kazakhstan, the world's third largest wheat exporter. Both of them have completely stopped export of grain. And other countries, Russia has now moved into a quota system whereby they say that we will look at last 2 years' trade and then we will only trade that much that was traded last year in the previous year and not more than that. And because there will be a huge demand and we do not want to exhaust our supplies by trading out. So we would like to keep our supplies at some kind of comfortable levels by rationing it in terms of keeping it fixed at last year's stock, last year's trade. Now, that means that there is some worry in terms of whether enough wheat will be available in the world market in the recent future. Now, how much rice and wheat do countries have already as stock? Data that is, again, coming from United States Department of Agriculture tells us that most of the big importers of rice and wheat in the world have something like a month and a half, or 2 months of consumption stored as buffer stock in their national territories. Now, this means that countries can hang on for about a month, maybe 2 months. And if beyond that, if the lockdown proceeds, and if countries refuse to trade, that is, if exports are restricted by the major exporters, then you will enter a period of very sharply rising global prices of food, even though we do not see it yet. I'll just come to that when I make the next point on prices. But let me just say that we do not see it yet. And this is primarily because there is some trade happening, limited, and many countries have enough stocks for a month or two. If the lockdown crosses May and moves into June or possibly July, then you can be extremely sure that world food prices will start rising and the problem of hunger, food riots, etc. are very likely to emerge at that point of time. Some people have called it a rising wave of food nationalism. People who support free trade are upset that countries are moving into protectionist modes and not trading. They are telling other countries that there is enough production, please trade. There are a lot of hungry people in the world, so please trade. But countries it's a very natural policy stance that sovereign countries would make, which is that let's keep our side safe, and then only after keeping our side safe can we begin to trade. Now, that's there's a sort of uncertainty there as to how countries will decide to whether countries will decide to trade after a month or two. But at this point of time, we are in a very precarious situation as to world food stocks and prices. If the lockdown proceeds beyond June, there will be trouble. That's a safe assessment we can make. Come to India. India is again in a safe situation with respect to total production of rice and wheat this year. There is likely to be a better monsoon next year, so coming next agricultural year, so that's likely to be a positive signal as well. But India is also notorious for being a country which has been more than sufficient in food production and availability, yet leaving large sections of its population hungry and malnourished. India's distribution system is in tatters. Neoliberal policy over the last 20-25 years has weakened a universal public distribution system into a weak, targeted sort of rather skeletal system of public distribution. And all this has meant that food production was never equivalent to food security in terms of consumption as well. India has about, a few weeks back, India had about 77 million tons of food grains in buffer stock. It came down when a lot of commodities were distributed through the PDS. It came down to about 55. Now the Rabi harvest has begun to come. More procurement is happening. And the stocks of rice and wheat have begun to rise up again. We are probably back to about 70, 75 million tons of rice and wheat in our buffer stocks, which is four times more than the officially stipulated buffer stock of rice and wheat at this point of time. For 1st April of every year, we are supposed to have about 21 million tons of food grains. We have 77 million tons of food grains. So in that sense, production-wise, it doesn't appear to be a problem. Again, distribution is what matters. What reaches people's hands is what matters. India is more notorious, as I said earlier, for keeping rats food secure and people food insecure. And that is something that is continuing, and it's likely to happen in the near future as well if policy does not correct itself markedly. So that's the point about food stocks, the first point, criterion that we chose to look at the problem of food and agriculture. But a more complete understanding won't be available if we do not look at food prices as well. It is a very important part. It should be a very important part of the analysis. What is happening to world food prices? Now, if you look at the Western world, United States, European Union, United Kingdom, etc., in those countries, food prices, food in the sense, what I mean is cereals, egg, milk, meat, in particular beef, pork, etc. These commodities, if you look at their price trends, they have followed a particular pattern from the beginning of the pandemic till now. In the initial period of the pandemic, food prices appeared to be soft, that is, towards till the third week of March, may I say, food prices were not rising in the Western world. This meant, because lockdown and all had not quite begun, this meant that the FAO's World Food Price Index or the World Cereal Price Index, if you examine that indicator, you will see that between February 2020 and March 2020, World Food Price Index fell by a moderate margin. World Cereal Price Index also fell between February and March 2020. Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO, says this has happened because of two reasons. What is it? First is there has been a sharp decline in the demand for food across the world. Number one, people have lost jobs, people have less incomes, and these less incomes have translated into less demand and consumption of food across the world, number one. But number two, they say that this is also because of the fact that corn prices have fallen very drastically during this time. That's partly because corn is used in the production of biofuels, and these biofuels have had great competition from even a negative price of oil that we have seen over the last few years. So, and people in the United States or Europe are not driving at all. United States is a big consumer of fuel because of the complete absence of public transport there. What this has meant is that there is absolutely no demand for biofuels. There is substitution into oil. And this has resulted in an extraordinary crash in corn prices in the United States. This has meant that this has had an impact on how the world food price or the world cereal price index would behave. Food demand and consumption have fallen, and B, corn prices have fallen very drastically. These are the two reasons that the FAO cites for the decline of food price index. Even though the FAO said this, if you look at other indicators, For example, if you look at some of the price databases of the Western world, and look at what has happened to retail prices of these commodities that I mentioned, cereals, rice, wheat, milk, egg, beef, pork, etc., you will see that towards the last week of March, there was a sharp rise in the prices of these commodities in the Western world. This is largely because there was enormous rush in supermarkets and so on, where people did great amount of panic purchases and stockpiling, including of toilet paper, as we have seen in some videos, where this has meant that there was a very sharp increase in demand for food items in the third and fourth weeks of March. This meant that rice, wheat, egg, etc., these prices really increased in the United States and Europe during the last week of March. Once this panic purchase period was over, by the second week of April, prices have started coming down again in the United States and Europe. So basically, you had an inverted U in terms of food prices in these countries. Panic purchases and stockpiling led to an increase in food prices during the end of March. But by the second week of April, they have now begun to fall. But some prices continue to rise. For example, egg prices are really ruling very high in the United States. Meat prices are also beginning to rise slowly. So you would see there is some tightening happening. These are largely because of supply bottlenecks as well. There is demand, but the supply bottlenecks continue to disrupt the movement of grains from go-downs to the retail markets and so on. So globally, you do not yet see a persistent rise in prices of food. Food prices have risen. They rose in end of March, but have come down now. And this coming down is not simply an indicator of less stockpiling or less panic purchase. It is also an indicator of less consumption of food. People are eating less food by many accounts that we have in the press. And this is because once the surge of panic purchase was over, the fall has been very sharp. Now, so prices globally have, in the Western world, followed an inverted U pattern. Look at a country like India, what has happened here. If you look at India, it is very difficult. If you look at RBI data, you will see something very interesting there. RBI says that if you look at the wholesale price index or the consumer price index that we have, which are collected and put together and released by the government of India, you see a certain trend in March, and then you see a certain trend in April. These two trends are very different in India. What is this I'm referring to? In the last year, in 2019, vegetable prices had risen very sharply. Now, this meant that wholesale price index and retail price index for consumer price index for food items rose because of the impact of rising onion prices, for example, in vegetables. And this meant that consumer price indices were rising towards the end of 2019. By January 2020 and February 2020, these food prices had begun to fall, particularly because onion prices had were slowly coming back, and vegetable prices hence fell, and food prices also fell. And hence, in March, you see a continuation of this decline, and you do see consumer price index and wholesale price index falling in March compared to February 2020. And we very well know from different sources that now food consumption has fallen among different sections of the population. If you look at March data, and then if you look at April data is not yet out, but the RBI has put out some feelers as to how food prices are behaving. I'll read out from the governor's statement, RBI governor's statement in this regard. He says, in March, the data showed a softening of food inflation, that is, food prices were falling, by around 160 basis points on account of easing of prices of vegetables, eggs, meat, fish, pulses, oils, fats, fruits, and sugar. And this is in part a continuation of the decline that began in January 2020, which was continuing into March, but it was also an indicator of falling demand for commodities after the lockdown began around 24th of March. He also says that data on 22 essential food items covered by the Department of Consumer Affairs suggest that food prices have increased by 2.3% in April so far, that is up to April 13, 2020, in a broad-based manner, though onion prices have continued to climb. So what the RBI governor is telling us is that there is... what the RBI governor is telling us is that there is, in some sense, a sort of fall in food prices in March, which is now slowly picking up in terms of consumer food prices in April. RBI data is still April 13th. Yeah, if you look at an update of that, Sudha Narayanan and her co-author have put together a paper in the last 2 days, which basically updates this data till April 21 or 23 of 2020. They say that this RBI assessment is right, and food prices are actually quite sharply rising in some places, though in large metros, they are, in some sense, not so sharply rising. According to these authors, what is happening is urban food prices are very rapidly rising in small towns as compared to large metros like Delhi, Mumbai, etc. In small towns, you see a much larger increase in retail food prices compared to the other larger cities or metropolises. So this reaffirms the assessment that while March was a period of low food prices, April is likely to be a period of rising food prices. Now, from different data that we have from other sources, we can arrive at an assessment of why this has been happening, why this particular trend has been witnessed. If you look at the data put together by Vikas Raval and his co-author on their website about a week back, that actually shows something that has been suspected for quite a while, for about which we only had anecdotal data in the past, which is that arrivals into most mandis, which are wholesale markets, have sharply fallen in 2020 March and 2020 April as compared to 2019 March and April, which are taken as some kind of a baseline. Now, this means that my own inquiries, I work closely with the APMC market in Vashi, which is just outside Mumbai, where about 700 to 800 trucks used to arrive daily before the lockdown began. But after the lockdown began, only about 100 or 150 trucks are arriving on a daily basis into that market. Now, that's a kind of fall of arrivals that you see in a market which serves the whole of Mumbai officially. Now, however, even this fall in arrivals into the market did not in the initial period lead to an increase in prices, because rice prices, wheat prices, vegetable prices, all of these were stable even though only 150 trucks were arriving into that market in place of 800 trucks. This means that there is a very sharp fall in demand for food or consumption of food, probably falling at a rate faster than the fall in supplies or fall in arrivals. There is no other reason why food prices may remain stable if this kind of sharp decline of supply or arrivals is noted. Demand would have fallen very drastically in this period. This is one. My own, this is a total anecdote. My vegetable vendor, who I visit every week, tells us that before the lockdown, he used to do business of about 4,000 rupees per day. And he used to get about 600 rupees profit from that sale. After the lockdown began, he's doing a business of only 1,000 rupees a day, which is 25% of what he used to do. And he is now getting about 100 rupees max from a day's trade. So I mean, don't take this seriously, but I just asked him, so what are people eating? Wo log to sirf dal chawal khake jee rahe aajkal. That was his assessment. Pure anecdote, but gives an assessment of what retailers feel during this time when faced with the question of what are people eating? They are not buying anything from you. So we have a lot of such evidence, which basically tells us that there is a sharp fall in demand. So Sudha Narayanan and her co-author's assessment is that, yes, there has been a sharp fall in demand, which did lead to a sharp fall in prices in the beginning. But slowly, because we have not set our supply bottlenecks right, because supply disruptions persist, if not rising, if not intensifying, we are actually seeing shortages emerging in areas which are rather remote, where logistics are more difficult to be extended to. Trucks do not reach there. There aren't enough loading and unloading workers there. Some of the remoter markets have closed down. So in small towns, what you see is a slow buildup of prices again because of these supply disruptions. And if these disruptions persist, prices are likely to rise further. And currently, this is something that I had noted for the Vashi market a few weeks back. This paper confirms it further. The sharpest rise has been in pulses. Pulse prices have risen across the board very drastically in the last few days. And this is largely because pulses are not handled by the Food Corporation of India, which has some amount of experience in dealing with food procurement and distribution. It is usually dealt with by NAFED, which has absolutely no experience in warehousing, storing, transporting, kind of demand that exists in different places and so on. The government has said that they will give 5 kg of pulses to every household during this period of crisis. But they have said the pulse of the choice for the state. That means each state can choose its pulse. So every state has chosen its preferred pulse, and NAFED has no clue how to meet this diverse set of demands from different states. This is the first time in their history that they are faced with a challenge of distributing food. They only knew storage. So they're suddenly asked to distribute, say they are scrambling to find ways to get lorries, logistics intact to get the distribution right. So food prices are... What we can say from food prices is there is some evidence that wherever supply disruptions persist, there is a rise in prices. And that is a clear trend that we have. And across the board, you also have evidence of sharply falling demand. Now, this is a safe assessment that we can make from the numbers that we have with us. Okay. Now, let us come to the third criterion that we had chosen to discuss, which is farmers. Now, farmers are faced with multiple troubles during this period. Now, there are sort of different ways of expressing this, but one clear set of problems that farmers across the board face is the following. We know that Rabi harvest is already happening. It's on its way. But procurement operations are happening very slowly because procurement needs workers who would load and unload, who would transport. You need trucks, you need drivers. Procurement has been happening very slowly. If you look at the data that we have, and again, through news reports, media reports, and so on, you will see that farmers in Madhya Pradesh have been told that you cannot bring to the market more than 80 kg a day. Right? 80 kilograms per day is the maximum a farmer can bring to a mandi one day for sale. Now, rest, you come another day. That's the question. That's the answer that mandis give. In some states, it has been raised. Some states allow up to 40 quintal. Now, even 40 quintal is small for a fairly large farmer who is likely to bring in grains and with some high levels of productivity. Punjab is the only state which has raised it to about 70 or 75 quintals per day, but most other states are 40 or less than 40. And Madhya Pradesh is an appalling low at 80 kilograms per day for a farmer. Now, so farmers who brought in 80 quintals to the market one morning discovered that they can sell only 80 kg that day. The rest has to be taken back and maybe brought again. So what they would do is they would either sell it to a local trader who is waiting to make some good money from this confusion that he's seeing happening in front of him. And so they'll sell to him at a very low price, or they will sell to him, sell a part to him and part to the mandi. And so there's enormous confusion that exists with respect to procurement. Procurement is in some sort of crisis as we speak. Second is, even if, one interesting statistic that we should take note of is that only 15% of India's farmers sell to any procurement agency. 85% of India's farmers do not sell to a procurement agency. They do not get MSP, and they sell to a village trader or an itinerant trader who visits. Now, this has also been disrupted in a big way. Traders are not visiting villages. Traders are not picking up commodities from the farmers' plots. And farmers have either not harvested or have harvested and bundled the grains and kept it on the bunds and not transported it. Some have managed to store it, some have not. There is a lot of there were rains which happened, so as a result people have lost crops due to the rains as well. So because trading has been disrupted, private trading has been disrupted, much misery has come to visit the farmers. So procurement has been disrupted, private trade has been disrupted. Okay, let's assume that the trader picked up the goods. Then comes the question of transportation. Trucking is in absolute chaos across the country. There aren't enough trucks to begin with, because trucks go to one place, they don't come back. Why they don't come back? Either they are stopped at some place on the way, or they drop those goods and come back, and they are stopped on the way back because some policeman sees that the truck is empty because he's coming back to pick up the load again, and he suspects that he's doing some there is some couple out there, and then he sort of keeps him for a day or keeps him for a few hours. All this accumulates into a major disruption of supply schedules. One estimate is that about 500,000 trucks are stuck in the different highways of the country last week. So trucks are not available, number one. Suppose trucks are available, truck drivers are not available. Truck drivers have gone home. They're all migrant workers, they've all gone home. Many of them don't come out because they fear police harassment. Police takes bribes, or police just beat up. They beat and talk. So as a result of this fear of harassment, they do not come out and drive. So truck drivers are absent. Let's assume truck is available and truck driver is available, but there are no loading and unloading workers because they're also migrant workers, and they've also gone home. So large mandis have this problem where for example, the Mathadi workers in the Vashi APMC market, they've all gone home to Konkan area where the villages are, and they are not there in the market to load and unload. This creates another set of disruptions. In many cases, mandis themselves have closed down. That is, there is no mandi. In fact, the APMC mandi in Mumbai, the APMC mandi in Pune, all of them have closed down because a few traders tested positive for COVID-19, and everyone got scared and the market was simply shut down. And this is another reason why food prices have slowly begun to rise, because many APMC markets have seen traders being infected with the virus, and sort of these markets have simply closed down. Even when they are open for only 2 days a week or 3 days a week, which is far less than what it used to be. So again, there is disruption in trade. The final point is about retail trade. retail markets have also closed down. There used to be a large number of retail markets. Every bus stand had a retail market. Every train station had a retail market. Every suburban metro station outside, there would be a retail market for vegetables. You saw wherever people congregated in bus stops, railway stations, and so on, there used to be a bustling vegetable market. All those markets have closed down. Police have either confined them to a ground somewhere with some protection, social distancing, and so on. But in terms of the number of traders who are trading, there is a significant fall in the number of traders. Another source of disruption out there. So as a result, across the board, across states, across crops, what you see is a disruption in trade, which has contributed to very low price realization for the farmers at the other end. What has been the nature of price falls that we have seen? There are really bad stories. Every day you open a newspaper, you would see that farmers in some part of the country who used to get, say, 15 rupees per kilogram for a particular vegetable, they are now getting 1 rupee per kilogram or 2 rupees per kilogram. That's the kind of fall that you see in at the farm gate price. For example, grape growers in different places, they simply have, the grape is a perishable commodity. You need to sell it quickly. It has to be taken to the wine factory. But wine factories are shut down because their migrant workers have gone home. And as a result, they simply leave the grapes in the plant itself. You can't also leave it in the plant. You have to take it out. Otherwise, it's a new. You have to prune it. Only then there will be new growth in the plant. So that's about a 1,000 crore loss in one district called Nashik itself. As we speak. Vegetables, as I said, which used to sell at 15 rupees per kg are now selling at 2 rupees per kg. Wheat prices in Madhya Pradesh, 2,200 rupees per quintal it was selling at. Now it has come down to 1,600 per quintal. Remember, MSP is 1,850 per quintal or 1,900 per quintal. In Punjab, vegetables, so for example, in Delhi, price of broiler chicken, these are livestock farmers, fell from rupees 55 per kg to rupees 24 per kg. Egg prices, 4 per egg was the price, rupees 4 per egg. It has come down to 1.5 or 2 rupees per egg at the farm gate. Banana, it's used to sell at 45 rupees per kilogram. Now it is selling at 25 rupees per kilogram. There is an extraordinary crash of prices at the farm gate. Whatever be the trend that you see at the retail level at the other end of the spectrum, at the farm gate, there is a clear, there is no, at the wholesale and retail level, we said they are fluctuating, some are rising, some are falling, etc. But here there is no such confusion. There is a clear fall of food prices at the farm gate level, which is the price the farmers receive, regardless of what has happened to the wholesale price or the retail price. And this is the second important hit the farmers have taken. Remember, right through the period after demonetization, Indian agriculture was in a deep crisis thanks to sharply falling prices anyway. This is the second major hit that farmers have taken under the Modi government, which is another important, which ironically came to power promising that it will double the income of farmers by 2022. It is most likely to halve the income of farmers by 2022. Now, the final point that I want to make, I think I'm reaching the end of my time, is about workers in the rural areas. And there is something to be said about migrant laborers here. I've written about this, but let me say this again. This is one category of workers that we had completely invisibilized in the last so many years. This is a category of workers who were central to the rural production process. I started one of my pieces from a movie that I saw, sort of not a movie, it's a mockumentary that I saw a few years back in 2004, which is called A Day Without a Mexican. It is the story of what happens in California, a city in California, if all the Mexicans disappear one fine morning. There are no Mexicans in that city from one fine morning. What will happen? that city is in chaos. City is in chaos in the sense that kitchens are shut down, restaurants are shut down, streets are swept, homes and offices are not clean, toilets are not clean, garbage is not picked up, babysitters do not report, grocery shelves are empty. The city is in absolute chaos. One character says in that documentary, it's the beginning of an apocalypse. So that was the importance of migrant workers, for example, the importance of Hispanic workers in the United States economy. Now, the absence of that migrant worker category is most critically felt in rural production systems today across the world. We often tend to think that Western agriculture is mechanized, they have harvesters, et cetera, and they can handle their agriculture without labor or laborers. That's only for maybe wheat, which has large harvesters, combined harvesters, but for vegetables, which are a very important category, because this is the time when many farmers in that California belt, moving slowly into the Midlands, start cultivating vegetables. And this vegetable cultivation cannot be undertaken with machines. You need people who are skilled people who would actually put the mulches in a particular way, arrange the fallows in a particular way, seed them, sow seeds in a particular way, and so on. It's a rather skilled job. The whole of US was doing this work with Mexican workers all this while, not just Mexican workers, South American workers. The whole of Germany was doing with workers from Bulgaria and Romania during this time, like the farmers in Punjab have been doing with workers in Bihar or Uttarakhand or UP. Now, the whole world has suddenly woken up to the reality that without migrant workers, you're finished. Farmers can't plant vegetables in the United States. There are no vegetables to be cultivated in Germany. Germany has a shortage of 60,000 workers as a result. Different countries have different estimates, but the estimates are really on the upper end. The US needs something like 2 lakh workers to handle their agriculture. And Trump, the biggest opposer of migrant work, has actually given more number of H-2A visas, which is the kind of visas that agricultural workers get to come from Mexico, harvest, and go back. Now, these kinds of visas have risen very sharply under Trump. Trump has said that we won't have any farmers in our country if we don't do it. Suddenly, even Trump has realized that Mexican workers, who he tried to block with a wall, are so central to his country's production process and, of course, to his election prospects as well. So that is something that has moved Trump. England, United Kingdom, wants to create a land army in that country, a land army of unemployed people in the work, for example, people who have lost work in restaurants, people who have lost work in different small enterprises in the urban sector. They're calling them to the rural areas, asking them to congregate into clusters or land armies who will move from village to village, county to county, and complete agricultural work in those areas. Agriculture minister was calling on, exhorting the population of that of the youth of Germany to help farmers so that we can all eat well the next year. India similarly is seeing a crisis where the rabi harvest in many places is not happening smoothly because of the absence of migrant labor. All these migrant workers are either at home, that is Bihar, UP, that belt, or they are somewhere. This is the time they come to the village, but they have not come this time. How farmers managing? Farmers are managing somehow, but the costs of harvesting have gone up significantly during this period. If you paid 2,000 rupees per hour for a particular machine, you are now paying 4,000 to 5,000 rupees an hour for a machine to be rented in for an hour. So the costs of harvesting have risen, as the news reports tell us. The other aspect is many farmers will do many of these operations with less care or less efficiently. And that's something that affects production productivity on the other end. That's a different story. So basically, this is a category of workers who you have treated them very badly. In the United States, they pay them less than minimum wage. They don't give them health insurance. They put them in extremely unclean surroundings where 35 people stay in a small apartment. That's the kind of living conditions that are available to them. In India, you also know that they are not just lowly paid; they are also treated with disdain. Their dignity is violated regularly. Think of it: a small theft happens in a village. The first finger is pointed at the migrant labor population in that village. Somebody goes and beats them up, or something happens. That's the kind of disdain with which you treat migrant workers. Suddenly, they are not available, and suddenly the farmers, large farmers in particular, and the government have woken up to the reality of the centrality of this category in the rural production process. Now, are things likely to improve in the future because of this? I don't see anything. Any major behavioral change on the part of government or farmers because of this crisis. Things are likely to continue, but at least if there is some realization that this is a category that has to be better treated, that has to be paid better wages, given better living conditions, that would be a small improvement. The question that earlier mockumentary ends with is, how do we make the invisible visible? I don't see that happening, and I think the invisible are likely to remain invisible for a while at least. Okay, let me conclude my initial set of remarks, which is that if you look at overall food production, there appears to be enough of production across the world and in countries like India, but globally, if countries don't trade and if the lockdown proceeds beyond June, there is likely to be trouble. In India, again, there is some amount of grain that is available in our buffer stock, but Indian government, even now, is not distributing that grain to its population. It is actually thinking of even giving permission to convert this into biofuel in many places because there is a demand for it, instead of giving it to the poor freely or even at low price. Now, so it's a tricky thing. Stocks do not mean consumption. Stocks do not necessarily translate to food security. And if government policies remain reactionary, then hunger and malnourishment are likely to rise. Food prices, it's complicated, but you do see that the sharp fall in consumption has led to depressed food prices in many places, but in certain other areas where supply disruptions have persisted, prices have slowly begun to rise. And that's true for particularly pulses, all types of dals. The third point that we mentioned was about farmers. Farmers are faced with a twin problem. One is they do not have enough laborers to harvest. And the second is that they are faced with the prospect of very low prices that they're getting for their produce because of poor procurement, because of less trading happening, because of less trucks, less truck drivers, loading and unloading workers, markets closing down, retail markets shutting down. All those have resulted in a sharp fall in prices for the farmers. Migrant workers are left with no work. They are somewhere. They are probably in their villages, but there are indications that many of them have absolutely no money to purchase food commodities. PDS is not being opened up by the government. This is the time when PDS should be operational, should be universal, but that is not being done by the government. In fact, it is astonishing that the pink press, the business press, and the neoliberal war horses of our country have suddenly woken up to exhort countrymen that this is the time for a new set of economic reforms to be undertaken. At a time when neoliberal policy has been absolutely discredited across the world, these of imperialism have suddenly woken up. And they have suddenly said, they have begun to say that this is the time for not just reform, they say deep reform in India. So that is they see the crisis as an opportunity. The prime candidate here is Raghuram Rajan. I want to tell every one of you, do not be carried away by the sway of the guy. He is a committed anti-left, anti-state activist, may I say, among economists. He's committed to that ideology. He is absolutely scared that this might lead to all the progress that neoliberalism has achieved over the last 20, 25 years. And he is constantly telling people that we should use this crisis as an opportunity for deep reform. There is a guy who writes for the Observer Research Foundation, ORF. He says this is a Balakot moment, he says. Or he says this is an Article 370 moment. And he says, I had to look up the dictionary for that word. This is a Rajasic moment, he said. So I said, what is this Rajasic moment? So I went and looked up the dictionary. It seems Mr. Aurobindo has said somewhere that Rajasic is the time where you move from Tamasic, Tamas means darkness, to Rajasic. It's kind of a spiritual awakening, it seems. It's time to be for a country to spiritually awaken into a new economic policy program. Absolute nonsense is being dished out by these guys across the world, in India in particular, where this toxic Hindutva ideology is totally fused with the neoliberal program on the economic side. So it's a time where in the immediate future, workers' movement, left movements, farmers' movements, progressive movements will have to keep the powder dry during this lockdown movement to ensure that we come out with full strength at the end of the lockdown, to ensure that this is not used as an opportunity by the neoliberals to take away whatever little rights and privileges a poor population has in this country, the workers have in this country, the farmers have in this country. It's a task cut out for us. As soon as this lockdown ends, we should insist that this should be used. We should, for us, it is a time for deep reform as well, but of a different, not the nonsensical Rajasic awakening. For us, it is a time to demand that we should have a comprehensive public health system, learning from the mistakes of this time in India. We should insist that about 1 to 1.5% of the GDP should be immediately invested in health so that we move away from the disastrous US model of private insurance sort of system of healthcare to a UK NHS inspired model of public healthcare, where everybody can walk into a public hospital and get treatment free for a range of treatments. That is something that is immediately necessary. For us, the opportunity for deep reform is to demand that there is a comprehensive public health system in India over the next 2 years. That has to be one major demand for sure. Of course, this is also an opportunity to ensure that many of the reversals of social policy that neoliberalism introduced after the night, not that India had any welfare state worth the name before 91. That's often a misnomer. That was some kind of socialist, Nehruvian socialist society that existed. But yet, there has been reversals that undoings that neoliberalism has done. It's time to demand that they also... It's time to demand that a very different pro-people paradigm of governance emerges from this crisis, where we move comprehensively away from the neoliberal paradigm and move towards a new pro-people, democratic, progressive paradigm. And that's something that we all will have to fight for in the very near future, as soon as this lockdown ends. Thank you very much for the time.